So good morning. So I'm very glad to be here. So my name is France Lamy. I'm a team member of CORI. So I'm a part of the Google.org. So my background, I'm an agricultural engineer by training. So I did a PhD in GIS decision making, multiple criteria, decision making at Oregon State University, and I've been at Google for 1 year and a half almost, and I've spent almost 15 years working at the international level with the United Nations and different research centers in Latin America and in Africa. So let's say 50% of my time, part of my time, I work with the Google Crisis Response Team at Google. So, and I will give you a short summary of what we do in terms of, different efforts in the disaster during the disaster cycle. Disaster cycles, for us, we consider different phases: so, prevention, preparedness, response, rehabilitation, and reconstruction. So as of now, our efforts have been mainly in terms of preparedness and response effort to crisis. Crisis for us, we're still, refining our criteria in terms of, when should we act and what should be the action as well that are triggered? That when do we involve our team at Google to be involved and how? So for us, a crisis is it's when there are, a vast amount of let's say human suffering. Natural resources are devastated, and there is a need for local communities need external assistance, either at national level or international level. And as you know, so rapid response is key in terms of to be efficient in terms of your response and to be to provide a timely and let's say very targeted response. You need to have real-time information. So real-time information about the population that might be affected, who they are, where are they, what are their needs, and you need to be able to monitor this information in real time over, certainly the response effort, but over time as well, throughout the relief and rehabilitation efforts. And there are many different organizations that are involved, some interested in providing, water, food, others it's shelter. Other are collecting data, so you need to have platform information systems that gather information from these, at multi-scale and as well multi-domain data. So and in real time, and Google is uniquely positioned to facilitate this data flow in times of a crisis. From data collection to publishing, aggregation, and disseminating to the world in a scalable, let's say, fashion. And we have demonstrated it. It started, a good example is the Katrina, Hurricane Katrina, where we communities use our technology to publish information about their needs, what was going on the ground. And as well, a few hours after the hurricane, we published more than 4,000 imagery that we made available to the world, and specifically to the responders, so that can inform their actions. So 4 years later, so perhaps you are aware, each Googler can provide 20% of his time to a project of his interest. So for instance, for the Katrina efforts, many Googlers that volunteer to help with this crisis. And 4 years later, now we have a dedicated team that we call the Google Crisis Response that has been operational for 6 months now. So we're still working on defining our strategy we do not want to duplicate efforts, and we need to certainly to coordinate ours to the ones of the, happening at
national and international level, we need to understand the landscape of of efforts. So for us, it's really to develop, build, extend technologies to facilitate the flow of information, so rapid dissemination of information. So it involves as well as processes, partnership development, and we have four angles in terms and the ultimate vision. Sorry, it's really to improve the global response, and support community key actions on the ground. So support relief responders. And we have four main entry points. So as I mentioned, building, extending technology to facilitate, to provide operational pictures to responders. As well, coordinate efforts with international organizations, building the capacity, because we want to make sure that what we technology we develop is being sustained and owned by these organizations, and certainly response to ongoing crisis. So for the last year, we have responded to more than 15 different crises around the world. So focus areas. So this is just just to give you a short overview. So some examples. So we have a virtual team. So our team is led by Phil Dixon and Jeff Martin, who are part of the GEO team. But I'm a member of that org. We have representatives from various units across Google. So we are really a virtual team. Part of my responsibility have been to build partnership with UN organization around data sharing, yes, to make sure that not just in times of crisis, but before and as well, because when a disaster strikes, it's not time to look for data and to use your contact. You need to be to have this information available beforehand. As well, building the capacity, certainly to use our GEO products, but there are other technology, like just the one that Gaetano demonstrated. So we just tested it, for instance, in an exercise that we had in Cambodia a couple of weeks ago. So it's really to expose different technologies out there and see if it's a good fit for these humanitarian organization and to improve their efficiency in terms of their response. So we have as well, we are interested, so something that we are very much interested indeed, it's how can we combine these different technology and facilitate real-time flow of information. Information could be, photos, could be imagery, could be SMS, GIS data, spreadsheets, blogs. How can we combine in real time all these different type of information and make it accessible across platforms? Could be the web, radio, satellite, etc. So we are engaged to help us, better understand, how can we, move forward on this. We're engaged with this Common Alerting Protocol community, which WMO, the World Meteorological Organization, is very much involved. So this is a standard that it's emerging that facilitate the flow of alerts information across system. But there are still many issues, to be resolved. How can you communicate with organizations that are not connected? How do you combine information from different formats? Etc. So we have a lot more to learn. So it's why we try to engage with various organizations within the US and outside as well. So just to give you an idea, so this is what we, an example, we act at, as I mentioned, so we monitor, disaster over time. So when one disaster, a crisis occurs, so we have a chart, decision matrix that help us decide if we should engage or not, and at in what fashion. For instance, for the one example, for the cyclone Nargis, so we partner with UNOSAT, and UNOSAT, it's one of the UN organizations that provide a satellite solution to organizations within and outside the UN. So they had tracks of the cyclone, and they had as well imagery about the flooded area, so we published this information on on our website, so that was made available to the world, and hopefully inform some of the response effort on the ground. Another example is we were involved, for example, in Dakota with the flooding, so we partner with the radio station and across the networks, the radio station networks in Fargo, so they embedded my map on their website, so they could provide in real-time information about the shelters, evacuated areas, and other information of key interest for the responders. Just lately, not a long time ago, so we in June of this year, so we partnered with UNHCR to create this virtual map that it's a Google Earth tour, so that that shows refugee camps across the globe, so provide some insight in the life of these refugees, and hopefully will raise awareness about human rights issues around the world. So there are different, as you see, there are different levels, that we are, that we are engaged with these different organizations. So when we have, as I mentioned early on, so we are still very new. So we are still trying to develop a comprehensive and proactive strategy to respond to a disaster. So what's coming next for us? So we will continue in the fall. So this is in the fall to engage with developers and users. So we will be contributing and even leading some of crisis hackathon activities. For instance, there is one we'll partner with Microsoft and Yahoo to see how together, we can try to address some of the main gaps, that needs to be addressed to be more effective. To have a more, proactive response. And we will be involved as well in different GIS conferences, and one of them is very interesting. It's in Uganda at Africa GIS. It's one of the biggest GIS conferences in Africa every 2 years, so we hope to be there. We'll provide training activities, and it will be, all these activities allow us to provide us with the opportunity to engage with more partners, more key institutions that can inform the way we do our work. So hopefully, I might meet you, to some of these. You might be, attending some of these, so perhaps we can continue the conversation there. If not, if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. I'm trying to figure out what it is that makes a crisis different from day-to-day activity in terms of the functionality that people want in terms of rapid access to information and analysis and so on and so forth. Obviously, there's greater urgency and greater consequences to whether that functionality can be provided, but are there different things that people want during a crisis, or is it just that certain
Yeah, but in terms of a crisis, for instance, in Myanmar, you may not have connectivity. So how our technology works without being connected? So this is a key or low bandwidth. So this is a key information. Yes, certainly. The network of how do you collect information in real time and then share it across? You need to be even more efficient because you need to share information across across organizations as well. Yes, certainly, all the time, but there are some constraints, for instance, internet connectivity, that's one, for instance, and as well, you need to have, you know, to have real-time information about, you know, as I was, you know, imagery, for instance, you need to, we are also working on developing partnership with space agencies to make this information, you know, available a couple of hours after a disaster. You want, for instance, for us, perhaps it's... in the U.S., it's you know, we believe that, you know, having access to know where are the health facilities might be obvious, but if you are in, you know, in other part of the world, these data might not be available. So it's, you know, and even some data in the U.S. might not be available in times of a crisis. You see what are the, you know, the Katrina. I'm sure you are aware of all the problems, and it happens here. So there are a lot of things that you can situation, a crisis situation, certainly impose more constraints to our processes and technology.
So everything you said, of course, is absolutely right. But I think you were right in your question, is that people are willing to compromise and just do it to make it happen. So whether it's privacy or lower resolution or less efficient or less perfect, they just do it and we'll then hack it together. So there's huge opportunity, not just constraint.
Yeah, I agree.
I think it's also just that in a crisis mode, people are not going through their routine channels. Yeah. And, you know, in a regular operation, you can develop over time what your information resources are and make sure they're right. Toward that end, have you thought about tools to help organizations do exercises and advance, you know, hypothetical
of
scenarios
course,
where they
yes.
say, you know, will I have the information resources if this kind of thing happens? Well,
yes,
I know how to
yes,
do that.
Yes, yes, yes. I have colleagues that will be testing our, you know, some of our technology in the U.S., but, you know, without connectivity. And so in, you know, crisis mode, let's say. Yes, and we, for instance, when I mentioned we were in Cambodia a couple of weeks ago. So that was the idea as well. So how does our tools work in such setting? So and then we may, you know, inform their development. Yeah.
So, one problem that arises in the crisis setting is that the agencies come together that don't normally work with each other. And one of the problems that, you know, I read about is that they use different record formats, different wireless frequencies, different modes of operation, so they can't actually communicate with each other.
Yeah.
So are you doing something about that?
You know, we try to support these communities, but it's really, you know, a global effort. But for instance, I mentioned the common alerting protocol. So if we can advance that standard, so that will facilitate the flow of information, at least, you know, in terms of alerts, you know, bringing if there are some, not for instance within the UN, a few organizations use that protocol, but if you can, you know, we can develop technology that use and take advantage of this and support, promote these standards. So hopefully, you know, more organizations will use this standard, and then you will improve the response. But certainly, you know, if such standards as well could be advanced for all type of information, that would be it's also our goal. It's really to facilitate the flow of information, starting with alerts, let's say. But then there's,
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.